when he assumed the reins of his part of a 200-year-old business legacy, the assets he inherited were valued at 6,000 crore rupees. This is 2011. Fast forward 8 years, the asset base is at 44,000 crores. That's more than 7 times growth at a time when the economy is struggling to grow at that speed. The RP Sanjiv Goenka Group has delivered growth which a country would, at a time when we are struggling for growth, would really be keen on learning from and understanding. Thank you very much, Mr. Goenka, for joining us here at the India Today East Conclave.
It's always an honor, Rahul. Thank you for having me.
You join us just days after, you know, one of the most legendary Indian businessmen, Mr. Rahul Bajaj, has stoked a massive debate across this country around the speed at which we are growing, around this sense that there is fear and paranoia amongst businessmen, that investment is being held back because there is fear of reprisal by government, that agencies would come and chase you. As one of India's richest and most significant businessmen, I want to understand from you what you think of this whole debate. Is there a sense of fear in India Inc. which is holding back and dragging down the India growth story?
Well, let me be very candid. I quite honestly disagree with what Mr. Bajaj said. He is entitled to his own view, and I'm entitled to mine. So I think, I really don't understand why he said what he did, but I actually believe that there is no such thing.
So you can say that there is no fear and that you disagree with Mr. Bajaj, but you can't deny the fact that private investment is at a 16-year low and that Indian industry is not investing in the India story. If fear is not what stops Indian industrialists from investing, what is preventing investments in the India story?
Indian industry invested very aggressively 3, 4, 5 years ago. And what happened was that almost all of us created huge capacities in anticipation of a 10%, 9% growth in the GDP. The demand hasn't quite grown to that extent, and therefore capacity utilization is not at its fullest. It doesn't make sense to invest in fresh capacity when you have underutilized capacity. And so I think it's going to take probably a year or 18 months before capacity utilization catches up, and then you will see the investment cycle going up again.
You've interacted with various governments in different capacities when it comes to policy making. What, according to you, is the difference between this government and previous governments? And I refer once again to Mr. Bajaj's statement. He said that, you know, we could criticize what the UPA was doing for policy paralysis and there was no fear of a blowback. He says the reason why industry doesn't speak is because they're concerned about a blowback. How do you compare the functioning of this government with the last?
You know, for the first time in several years, I see the will and the determination to do a structural change. In the past, it was pretty much the way it was. For the first time, you're seeing change at different levels. This government is actually reaching out to the Aam Aadmi like no other government has. So the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, the Har Ghar Jal Yojana. And there's somebody who's sitting here who had told me in March that the BJP is going to win this election hands down because the common man, the common woman actually more than the man, is with the BJP because they feel that their dignity is preserved with this, with the toilets, with the shauchalaya. And I think there are huge social structural changes, corporate structural changes that this government is doing. And frankly, that's the fundamental difference.
So there are two numbers when it comes to a discussion around the Indian economy which are very important. One is the promise of 10% growth, which is what brought the BJP and Prime Minister Modi to power, the promised land which they would lead us to. And the other is the 3.5% growth, which was sarcastically called the Hindu rate of growth, which scarred us and dragged us for decades after independence. Today, we are closer to the 3.5% than we are to 10. Why do you think that's the case? And if you were advising Ms. Sitaraman or Piyush Goyal or Amit Shah or the Prime Minister, what would your policy prescription be?
Rahul, whenever you do a structural correction, you do a structural change, it takes a little bit of time for that change to be accepted, for it to be impacted. And I think we are in that phase where this structure is being changed. So you will have some pain while this change is happening. I think the whole transition to a digital economy is something that's very significant. And it's something that we hadn't even imagined 5 years ago.
Now, there are two debates that go on side by side. One of them is, and I'm interested in knowing your thoughts on this, that Indian industry has been used to, for a long period of time, a certain style of operation, where loans would get evergreen, industry wouldn't have to pay up, and therefore you could keep building your debt without having to worry about paying back. And that this business of crony capitalism has now come to a halt, and industry is therefore trying to adjust to a new way of operating. To what extent do you believe that this is one of the reasons why industry is in the kind of shock that it is?
You know, this is something that had to end, should have ended long time ago. It's great that it's ending now. So, I mean, I don't think anyone in his right senses will not support this kind of a thing ending. If you've taken a loan, you damn well repay it. I mean, there's no question. I mean, this whole approach of liya hai, nahi payment karna hai, dekha jayega, I think that has to stop. It has stopped. So fundamentally, another structural change, a great change. And yes, that also has a contribution towards people investing. Loan liya hai, payment karenge, nahi karenge, toh capacity to baitha lo. Now you are becoming that much more conscious of that capacity being profitable because you say loan wapas karne.
You say what we are dealing with right now is the consequence of significant structural change which will have long-term advantages to the Indian economy. Do you believe too many of these significant structural changes have been rolled out at the same time, thereby destabilizing the equilibrium which was propelling the economy?
No, I think, frankly, you have to deal with it, according to me, I mean, as quickly as you can, because one in isolation would not really bring the entire change. And you will have pain for a couple of years, but then you will see the economy bounce back stronger, much stronger.
The government has rolled out over the past few months after the budget more than a dozen substantial measures aimed at reviving different sectors of the economy. What more would you like to see the government do, either in the budget or before the budget, to ensure that we don't slip further, but we actually bounce back?
Again, I have a slightly different approach to those of many people from my fraternity. I think this whole thing of going to the government and asking, ye kar dijiye, ye kar dijiye, ye kar dijiye. It's high time we sort of got that to an end. And I'm not saying it from an idealistic perspective. I'm saying frankly, what more can the government do from a policy perspective? Individual sectors may have issues, that's a different matter, but at a macro level, can anyone stand up and say, this is a structural change that we expect and this will impact the economy positively? In all the discussions I have, I don't hear any such suggestion. So, you know, it's all very well to say we expect this and they should have done this, but what is this?
So you're saying industry should take onus to propel the economy on its own without being dependent on government?
I think we for a long time said we don't want to be dependent on government. We want to get away. Government should not interfere with the economics of decision making. So that's what we should do. We should focus on our efficiencies. We should actually focus on making our facilities far more competitive, spend more money on research, innovation. In the past, we couldn't do that because we were not allowed to have scale. Today, most of the companies have scale. So you can actually invest in research, you can invest in innovation. And even in our company, in a very small way, we are beginning to see innovation. And that's probably the way to grow. I mean, in our music company, which is not a big company, we had this product called Karva, which actually was one of the most disruptive music products in a digital age. In our utility, 51% of our bills are digitally paid now. And when bulk of your customers are below the poverty line, so that in itself is many steps forward. I think in our chemicals business, we've actually got 3 patents for products. It's the first time that it's happened. And I'm sure this is just about the beginning, and there's so much more that can be done.
So one of the government's biggest bets has been a sharp cut in corporate tax rates with a revenue foregone of 1.25 lakh crores in the hope that industrialists will start investing with the extra earnings that they have. However, we've seen multiple research reports after this saying that most of the Indian companies are likely to sit on their extra retained earnings as opposed to pumping them back. Do you believe that this move, which is really Prime Minister Modi's big hope, that industry will invest again with the extra money, will that have the desired result a few months, years from now? Or do you think that it's just extra money in everybody's balance sheet?
I don't think you will see the immediate effect of that. People are not going to sort of invest the additional profit saved from taxes instantly into projects. But I think give it 2 years or 3 years and you will see it getting back.
I'm curious to know from you what you think about the debate around trade. There was a big decision before India on whether or not to join the Global Trade Alliance, the Asian Trade Alliance, the RCEP. Do you believe we did wisely by staying away from this Asian trade bloc? Or do you think it would have been better for India to get in and be a part of this Asian trade bloc?
You know, I'm not an expert on this subject, and therefore I must qualify whatever I say by saying that before. But having read in the newspapers, heard on television channels, having heard what Mr. Goel said after the summit or the meet, I think it's also time when India can demand and get its fair position in these trade blocks. So it's not about joining them at any cost. Is joining them at our terms, and I think that's what India has done.
One of the reasons we stayed away and why I asked you this question is because the government didn't think we were competitive enough at this moment to be able to deal with the flood of imports which have come from a country like China. If India Inc. is to get more competitive, what are the kind of reforms you would like to see?
More incentives, more encouragement on research. I think that is something that's fundamental. What bothers me sometimes is state governments, DISCOMs owned by state governments, reneging on power contracts. For example, the renewable energy contracts, wind energy, solar energy contracts which have happened. How do you get confidence that there is consistency of commitment? Stability of an agreement which is legally enforceable to be enforced. So I think that's really all that we are asking for. Encourage us to research, encourage us to compete, and honor your commitments.
No, but this is a big political problem as well. You would have seen what happened in Andhra Pradesh. In Amravati, the new Chief Minister Jagan Reddy wants to upturn all the decisions taken by Chandrababu Naidu, including shifting the capital away from Amravati now towards Vijayawada, where he says that there's some government land and a refinery which he wants to take. We're seeing what happened just last week in Maharashtra, where the new Chief Minister Uddhav Thackeray on a project like the RA project where they're building a metro shed, or for example, the bullet train project, which is the Prime Minister's pet project linking Mumbai and Ahmedabad, is wanting to do a review. If all governments, because of political populism, do this, where does that leave industry? In Amravati, there was a deal with a Singapore consortium. Here, there is a soft loan from the Japanese government. If a country can't enforce its contracts, then what will you honor and agree to?
So exactly. So if you ask me, what is it that we are looking for from government? It's not only central governments, it's state governments. We are looking at enforceability of contracts and commitments that they've entered into. And that, I think, will be a huge step forward in reinforcing the confidence within industry.
The reason I asked this question is because I wanted to bring you to the issue of land reform. How much of a disappointment is it for you that even a government as powerful as the Narendra Modi government at the center, with the kind of people's mandate that the BJP enjoys at this moment, is not willing to touch the issue of land reform, without which we simply cannot have the kind of industrialization that a country needs, country like India needs at this stage of its economic evolution?
I sincerely hope that this government will address this sooner rather than later. If they can address, if they can't address it, then nobody else can. You have a decisive Prime Minister, you have a decisive number two, you have an overwhelming mandate. I mean, and I firmly believe that they will. It's a question of time, it's a question of their, they obviously have other priorities before this, but they will address it.
Do you think the government needs to expend some more of its political capital on tough economic decisions? A lot of their political capital they expend on issues like Article 370, issues now like the Citizenship Amendment Bill, which are core to their ideology and are tough decisions in terms of making them acceptable to people. But when it comes to, and you mentioned land reform, which would help the economy in the long term, maybe unpalatable to people in the short term, but would help the India growth story, do you think they haven't expended enough of their political capital on significant economic reform?
When you look at it from a national perspective, 370 was way more important than land reform. And as an Indian, I think it's, and I'm sure you do too, I'm sure everyone here does too. It's great. I mean, you know, frankly, why should you have 370? I mean, at least people in my generation, I don't think even understand the rationale, I'm sure, in your generation, even less so. So those are bigger priorities. And I think we have to understand that it's not only about industry and economy. Economy is a part of a nation. And there are many other priorities.
There's a huge controversy and a huge debate at this time on the issue of electoral bonds. And we've heard from so many politicians on where they stand on this. The BJP thinks it's a move towards transparency. The opposition says it increases opacity, gives the government unbridled power in knowing who's spent how much money on which company, on which party. As one of India's leading industrialists, I want to understand from you, Mr. Goenka, do you believe electoral bonds enhance transparency in the manner in which Indian elections are formed?
Certainly, and they're far more transparent than election funding was in the past. I mean, I don't think there is any debate in this. And I don't think there is any political party who hasn't received electoral bonds. And at least it's a cleaner, better way of giving money to political parties than the past.
If you were asked, how do you make India's elections more transparent and cleaner, how would you think that issue should be approached?
You know, this is not my area in the sense that I'm not in politics. I don't really understand how elections are fought. But as a corporate citizen, all I can say is, if I can pay a political party by check, I would much rather do that. And if electoral bonds is that vehicle, so be it. I mean, it's much better. It's board approved. It's discussed openly. It's transparent. It's by check. So I would think that it's much better than what we've had in the past.
You know, we've discussed issues of economic development. From there, I want to move to something more private. When you were taking over your part of the group, what is it that your father told you? And as Shashwat sits here in the audience, I want to understand from you, what is the part of your legacy that you would like be a part of his DNA as he runs the business into the future?
I wish I could summarize it in a couple of sentences. My father always said that you have to be good, you have to be fair to people, you have to be humane. And before you take a decision, particularly a decision involving people, just put yourself in the other person's shoes and then take the decision, and almost always you will not go wrong. To me, in addition to that, I think we've got to be the most efficient or amongst the most efficient units in terms of operations in the industries that we operate in. And that is the only thing that will give us the right to win, the right to compete. And without that, we will not survive the future.
Shashwat, if I can have a mic and I can throw him a surprise question, what's the biggest lesson you've learned from your dad?
I think there are quite a few, hard to pick one, but I would say probably at least at work, to use logic to drive your decisions and not just your will to drive your decisions, I think.
In any business enterprise, as you commence a new innings, there'll be things you like about the way things are run, and there'll be things you'd like to change. What is it that you'd like to change?
I haven't thought about it yet.
He's being very diplomatically correct. He's like, "Hey, bada dangerous sawal hai, ispe kuch nahi bolne ka hai. Say for that we have to go back in the same car as you, so smart." You know, but you know, it was interesting as I just walked out for a moment. I saw lots of people clicking selfies with you, like very young people, and you know, that was an interesting moment. Like, so, you know, obviously, because of all the businesses that you run over here, in addition to being an industrialist, I see that you're a bit of a star, which was interesting. It's like almost like Ganguly outside, you've got that kind of star appeal in your own city. Is that why, unlike a lot of other business families from Kolkata, you've chosen to stay back and not move to Mumbai?
I decided not to move out of Calcutta because initially, most of my businesses were headquartered in Kolkata, and this was my place of work. In today's context, it really doesn't matter where you live. You can control your business from wherever you are. Technology has enabled that, so that's really not an issue. But I think I just love being here. I'm a born Kolkatan. I mean, my heart is there, my soul is here. So, I mean, for me, I can't imagine myself living outside. I spend time in Delhi, I spend time in Mumbai, I spend time in London. I enjoy these cities, I enjoy the people. But for me, if I have a choice ever of living, I will live here.
I have a trick question for you. Who's the better administrator, Narendra Modi or Mamata Banerjee?
I learned a lesson very early on in my life. My brother Harsh and I were two sons that my father had. And he always asked people, "Inme se kaun acha hai?" And one or the other was unhappy. So my mother told me that never ever get into comparisons.
So if the Indian Foreign Service were for looking for smart, seasoned diplomats who would be able to do a verbal trapeze, you know, here's a good candidate, you know, just ensure that everybody stays happy. What is it that you like or dislike about the Mamata model of governance in terms of trying to make Kolkata and West Bengal a state that actually invites and attracts industry?
Let's not forget that for 34 years, you had no development in the city and the state. The whole state was in a state of decadence. From there, to take it up and to get it to a situation where you are under consideration is in itself a feat. And I think it's a huge achievement. And no matter what anyone says, you cannot take this away from the current administration. So I think it's a very 34 years, no roads were built, no roads were repaired, no buildings were painted, no parks were built. I mean, no industry came in, nothing. And people here in the state had almost forgotten that they can win. So I think that feeling, that confidence, that the spirit that we can do it had gone away. That has come back, and to my mind, that's a huge positive.
But while things may be better than they were, the moment anything nice is said about Kolkata, there's so many claps, and I love that about Kolkata. So much spirit just for the city, and a sense of belonging. You know, you don't always see this in Delhi. You don't always necessarily see this in Mumbai either. But the spirit of, you know, wanting to be with each other, backing each other, is just very strong. I want to tell you a story. We went to his office yesterday, and they had lots of books, lots and lots of books stacked all along the new office. And that was very interesting, because as you go to other industry titans' office, you know, books is not what you find over. This is a very, very Kolkata business, like any Kolkata boy, you know, the books will be all over, and that was just all over your new office as well.
You know, books, most of the books are my father's books. They are books that he's read. And through them, I somehow feel, and so does Shashwat, that we have him still with us, present, in some form. So I think it was a deep emotion.
I want to understand from you, of all the sectors where you're foraying, and there's so many different areas where you've just entered, which ones are the sectors that you're most bullish about and why?
My future bets are going to be on the consumer-facing industries. So it's going to be on retail, it's going to be on the FMCG part of the business, it's going to be the new chain that we've acquired, Nature's Basket. So those are the businesses that we are going to grow very aggressively. It's not to say we won't grow our other businesses. We are growing them. Each one of them is growing. We are investing in carbon black. We are investing in power. We are investing in BPO. We are investing everywhere. But these are the businesses where we will grow the most, and we will put the maximum amount of capital in the next few years.
You mentioned retail, and retail not just in India but world over faces a massive challenge from the likes of, say, the Amazons and the Flipkarts, where if I can sit back at home and order whatever I want on my cart, why will I make the effort of going all the way to a Nature's Basket or any retail store?
It's also about, I mean, there will be a certain segment and certain percentage of the market that will shift online. But there will be a certain segment of the market that will want to go for the experience and the indulgence. And when you want to spend time, it's about how do you spend time in a manner that you buy something that you want and you also get entertained in the process. So it's a combination, and that's what we are trying to do.
So we're out of time in this conversation. I want to thank Mr. Sanjiv Goenka for joining us here at the India Today Conclave East. Can we have a very warm round of applause, please?
Thank you, Rahul. Thank you.